morning, Patrick. Hiya, Sandy. Greetings, Squidward. Hello, Bikini Bottom.
All right. So I have now seen the SpongeBob musical on Broadway, and given everything I had to say about Sponge Out of Water on this channel, I think it's only fitting that I offer some thoughts about the musical. And let me say right off the bat that I found it to be a giddy delight that made for an extremely charming and entertaining celebration of the SpongeBob characters and world. The songs were great, very much all in the spirit of SpongeBob, while also being engagingly varied. The actors did a wonderful job capturing the spirit of the characters. I can't stress enough just how utterly perfect Ethan Slater is as SpongeBob, and the imaginative production design was nothing short of beautiful. With that said, this show is in preview, so now's when you change stuff, and there isn't a moment to lose, so let's cut to the chase. Obviously, everyone involved with the production is watching this and cares what I have to say, so they should all take note. Here's what I would change to make the SpongeBob musical all the better. I'm not going to really focus on form, since the form, being the production design, is fantastic, and how it derives from a multitude of found objects, like you have umbrellas basically becoming jellyfish, and a bunch of cardboard boxes kind of becoming a volcano, and the translation of cartoonist aspects like the sounds of footsteps and heads turning, blur lines, the physics of how arms can stretch out improbably long. All of that was a delight that made for an innovative and engaging use of the full space, and very much in line with the imaginative creativity that SpongeBob would obviously be all for himself. So this is going to be a content-focused discussion, and as such, spoilers are ahead. Alright, so for starters, I think the main concept of the show's storyline is great. SpongeBob's blissful life in the simple town of Bikini Bottom is thrust into chaos with the news that a volcano is to erupt and potentially destroy everything and everyone he loves. Now, this is the exact sort of juxtaposition that you want with a big SpongeBob project. You have to keep in mind that anyone going to see this might be bringing some baggage. You're not just playing to the initiated here. This isn't TV anymore. You're on Broadway. Who knows who's gonna get dragged to this show? When you have something as bright and silly as SpongeBob SquarePants, you have to be prepared for it to get sneered at. And the best defense is to inject a surrogate, a humorous representative of the cynical skeptic, into the show. A Squidward, if you will. Many of the show's best episodes revolve around Squidward being reluctant to indulge in SpongeBob and Patrick's antics, only to eventually not just commit to them, but to totally run with them. You can see this when he moves to Squidville to get away from them, and then eventually becomes their reef blower playing equivalent in this squid-centric society. Or when he looks down on SpongeBob playing with a paper only to suddenly find it so fun he'll give up everything he owns for it. Or when he condescends them for playing with a box a TV came in, instead of actually using the TV, only to become obsessed with its potentially magical qualities.
And with nothing but their imagination, much as we might get into a black box theater, they're able to imagine that they're mountain climbers or they can launch a space shuttle. And SpongeBob knows that the box is not one of these things. It's all of these things all at once.
Let me get this straight. You two ordered a giant screen television just so you could play in the box.
Pretty smart, huh?
I thought it wouldn't work.
We, as a cynical adult, are the Squidward. We are going to think this is stupid until the wonder and fun and imagination of it hopefully become too irresistible to resist, and then both us and Squidward will give in to the silliness and run with it. Plankton is used to similar effect in the Sponge Out of Water movie, condescending and mistrusting SpongeBob as he gradually goes from being annoyed with the antics that surround him to utterly flabbergasted by how strange they are to eventually just being along for the ride. It's a classic point-counterpoint structure. So when you throw in the gravitas of volcanic eruption into the mix, you're setting up a pretty big counterpoint, one that certainly is poised to take advantage of the extended runtime of a theatrical production. Or as Squidward puts it in the musical itself, the world is a horrible place filled with fear, suffering, and despair. But I think the musical needs to lean into said fear, suffering, and despair more throughout. We need to see SpongeBob's worldview be actively challenged by more than just the potentiality of a looming threat of a volcanic eruption. And more stuff like this innocent line.
I never thought my world could end. I only wanna hang out with my friends.
Would go a long way in introducing a sense of doubt that maybe SpongeBob's outlook is ignorant rather than optimistic. Maybe he's not so much imagining solutions as he is pretending the problems don't exist. Maybe the world is a horrible place, and I'm totally wasting my time making a video about a SpongeBob Broadway musical rather than offering helpful critical suggestions towards high art like I believe I am because I'm insane. See, you need that balance of light and dark. And here's how to do that. Okay, so the opening number, Bikini Bottom Day. Without a doubt, one of the best songs in the whole show. It does an excellent job establishing all the principal characters of SpongeBob, plus some tertiary ones you would never expect to be there. And it also establishes all the musical's primary concerns in a bright, well-paced, and inviting manner, like any great opening number to a show should. It even contains references to Mermaid Man, I Went to College, and The Fourth Wall to boot. Now, when I listened to this number on the soundtrack, I was incredibly struck by one specific moment. When SpongeBob implores Mr. Krabs for the position of manager of the Krusty Krab, a plot point, of course, lifted from the original 2004 film, aka the definitive model for any extended SpongeBob project, he is swiftly dismissed, and Krabs tells him that he'll never be anything more than a fry cook. SpongeBob's ambitions crushed, he retreats to a sad moment of self-reflection.
Why can't he see? I wore my good shoes and I've got my tie on.
And in spite of his apparent disappointment, as soon as the restaurant opens up,
SpongeBob, get in the kitchen! It's opening time!
He shakes off the negativity instantaneously and reassumes his joyous demeanor, claiming it to be an extraordinary day, while all the other townsfolk remark on how ordinary it is.
It's a typical,
incredible,
irregular,
exceptional,
extraordinary.
This was tremendous, showing how the character bounces back even in the face of utter lack of acknowledgement. A true testament to his optimistic attitude that the show should continue to present with challenges. It's a strong transition that speaks volumes. But in the actual production itself, they've now reworked it so that this section of the opening number is placed shortly after the opening number has already concluded, in another scene. Well, now it just feels like an afterthought. These are the grounds for SpongeBob's entire character arc in the musical. They should be established upfront in the very first song anyway. But especially when you present this dramatic tension in the context of an otherwise upbeat song. You've got some great and telling mood whiplash for your main character that you don't want to put to waste in favor of a change that's nothing but clunkier. So I would say to make it the way it was before. Then we have the David Bowie pen song No Control, spelling out the doom and gloom of apocalyptic fear that the town has towards the impending volcanic eruption, which has, since the Chicago version of the show, been moved up to be the show's second song, now before BFF, a common charming ditty about SpongeBob and Patrick's friendship. This is a change that, upon reflection, works really well, seeing as 1, the anxious nature of No Control makes for a strong direct counterpoint to the bright opening number that immediately follows it, and 2, SpongeBob's eternal optimism gives grounds for the lighthearted BFF to follow. So we've got optimistic, followed by pessimistic, followed by optimistic again. The balance looks to be on track, except for one thing. At the end of No Control, we see SpongeBob try to rationalize that the situation isn't so bad, until he too gives into the madness and mourns the fact that he has no control.
Everyone's so scared and sad, just one volcano that's not so bad, until Bikini Bottom's gone, let's all
turn comes far too early in the show, and isn't reflected by his actions for the rest of the story, which are all about attempting to control the situation as best he can. So I think we need to take this verse and move it later in the show. Where? Well, you think I wouldn't have an answer? When Patrick is inducted by a group of worshipping followers who become quite taken to his so-called words of wisdom in this time of crisis, which, by the way, that number could and should be cut in half, and then decides to leave the group of heroes, and we see the townsfolk again, we can see some hysteria there, and then SpongeBob tries to calm them down with the hopeful start of his No Control verse, and then, as already happens at this point in the show anyway, more debris, brilliantly worked into the Rube Goldbergian nature of the stage design, proceeds to rain down on them, and then we get his scream leading into the rest of his verse. This gives Sandy a strong motivation to go into the soothing Tomorrow Is that we have there already as some warm encouragement for SpongeBob before we bow out of Act 1, or, as the French narrator puts it, enjoy your last intermission ever. So if that's our endpoint for Act 1, we're going to have to really build up the ever-growing anxiety that there is no control to be had in this horrible world. How do we do that? Well, the rest of the town in general needs to take the situation a bit more seriously than they currently do. As tempting as they may be, we can't just do jokes like Krabs' response to the actual apocalypse being, "Great, now I'll have to close me restaurant," or whatever. Not only is it out of character for him to be that greedy and Jarrow, it doesn't serve the counterpoint of the story well if other characters are being too petty to seem actually afraid, because SpongeBob needs to seem joyous while they're actually cynical. Showing exploitation and manipulation amidst the crisis is welcome and should definitely stay in the show, but we need to make a more conscious effort to get across a sense of desperation. Not even just that, maybe some sad truths about life that aren't just directly due to the forthcoming apocalypse, and thus have a deeper meaning. So let's get into some ideas. You have SpongeBob right there on stage during this big Pearl Krabs duet, and he's currently not really doing anything. So why not take this opportunity to parallel Pearl and SpongeBob a bit? They both feel ignored by Mr. Krabs, after all. Pearl's story in the show is that her father wants her to take over as manager of the Krusty Krab when she graduates high school, despite her having no interest and also having an absolutely killer voice that Krabs doesn't seem to notice. Add a few lines of dialogue where they share these feelings of not being respected by Krabs, and maybe even go so far as to contextualize Pearl's part of the duet as being something that SpongeBob actually hears. He hears her amazing voice and directly sees it be ignored, showing just how unfair the world is. While we're on the subject of Mr. Krabs, I think we need to address the one big example of over-exaggerated negative characterization in the show, and that's him trying to hide his money from the rest of the town when they desperately need funds to try to splurge for safety precautions. Yes, I know I'm saying my whole point is to paint the picture of a potentially horrible world throughout the show, but the keyword potentially, it can't be unforgivably horrible in order for SpongeBob's ideology to ultimately prevail. So I think the best way to fix this is to have Krabs still exploit the Bikini Bottomites through last Krabby Patty ever deals and such, but emphasize that he thinks this whole conflict is going to blow over and that no one's in any real danger. He doesn't really believe it's the apocalypse. Once Pearl convinces him of the genuine weight of the situation, he should willingly give up all of his money to pitch in and help. Another thing to build on. There's a thread that I believe has been added on in the Broadway transition, which is more of this concept that Old Man Jenkins leads the Bikini Bottomites in a protest group blaming Sandy since she's a foreigner. And this definitely strengthens the case for the world being an awful, bad, nasty place, but I think we need to have SpongeBob respond to it more, acknowledge it more. He needs to recognize and take more active issue with the fact that the townsfolk are being so prejudiced. We have this really pretty scene in the show when Sandy, with the intention of leaving Bikini Bottom forever, makes one last stop at Jellyfish Fields, wistfully mentioning she thinks she'll miss this place most of all. Why is that, though? What if you had this dialogue where Sandy says how she's attracted to this spot, Jellyfish Fields, since, of course, the ocean felt very strange to her, but it's the jellyfish that felt the most alien of all. So in a way, she actually relates to how out of place they are. Then SpongeBob could say, I used to get really scared by the jellyfish. I just didn't understand why they belonged here, and when I walked through their fields disrupting their environment, I think they felt I didn't belong there either. But one night, as I wondered what the purpose of these faceless creatures was, as I lay hospitalized for my sting wounds, screaming out of involuntary pain, I realized that the most wonderful stuff down here is the stuff that you'd never think could exist. But the reason it's so special is that it does anyway. And then Sandy would go, huh, so is that why you live in a big fruit? And SpongeBob would go, eh, and the rent's affordable. Oh. And since I was just suggesting SpongeBob inject a little positivity there, let's go back to our classic sorts of negativity, the Squidward. Remember, no employee wants to be a Squidward, but someone's gotta do it. Now, Squidward has these ambitions in the show of putting on his own theatrical spectacular and having a long-awaited stint in the spotlight. Krabs, of course, dismisses these dreams, but I think we should definitely have a quick beat in which SpongeBob encourages Squidward to never give up, since one day his moment will come. Because later, when Bikini Bottom collectively decides to have a charity fundraiser, the beloved recruited band, the Electric Skates, tells Squidward he can open for them if he gives them everything they ask for on a very demanding list, and Squidward relishes the opportunity. In this moment, you could quickly have him be like, it's all finally happening, I just had to keep waiting for my moment. Maybe SpongeBob was right after all. Now you know it's the end of the world. Because of course, this ends in crushing defeat when the Skates not only deny Squidward his chance, but quit the show, leaving him to have just a deliriously hallucinatory showstopper of a number that ultimately leaves him sad and alone on stage. What could otherwise be seen as a tangent, albeit a highly enjoyable one, can, with a very minor adjustment, now tie in all the more closely to the core thematic concern of the show. Another thing. As SpongeBob and Sandy scale Mount Humongous, the volcano, once we near the end of the extremely well-done John Legend Penn duet, I Guess I Miss You, and Sandy urges SpongeBob to keep going, a small change that would make a huge difference is giving a moment when he says, I don't think I can do this. And she says, come on, SpongeBob, I know that's what everyone said, but, and that was okay. No, it wasn't okay. I'm used to that, though. No one ever really believes in me, and I mean, I can't blame them. but I always thought I could count on Patrick. Now even my best friend in the whole world gave up on me. So who am I kidding? We still need to try and save it, even if we fail, but... what? But maybe the world really is a horrible place. And then Plankton sabotage for the volcano activates, and you go, ah, I'm sorry, world, I'm sorry, I didn't mean it! Now, I've neglected to talk about the one other main character, because I've saved him for last, Plankton. He should definitely be utilized more. For what I heard, in the previews, he simply just had his scheme to mind control everyone in Bikini Bottom once they got into his protective bunker thing, and didn't ever actually actively antagonize our heroes. We saw him briefly test his mind-controlling capabilities, but that was just on an innocent fist with a broader scheme in mind for later. But now in the show, in the Broadway transition, once he catches wind of the hero's plan in Act 1, Plankton does directly attempt to kill SpongeBob and Sandy surreptitiously from a far distance while they're scaling the volcano in Act 2. Once again, we definitely have another step in the right direction, but I feel we can go even a little further so that we can kill two birds with one stone. Give Plankton more to do, and inject some more darkness into the proceedings. So there's this whole aforementioned subplot of Patrick gaining a set of followers, right? Patrick basically comes up with all of these simple-minded ideas, and yet this group of characters is always enthralled by them, contriving some sort of deeper meaning to what he says, even if it's something as stupid as life smells weird, and basing their entire lifestyle around him, declaring him to be the savior of the apocalypse. It's definitely a really fun idea, although I do again stress they should cut the musical number about it in half, and it ties into the main storyline, motivating Patrick to depart from SpongeBob and Sandy in the end of Act 1, leaving them without the brawn that they need to save the day. But what if later, at the end of the duet, I Guess I Miss You, when Patrick chooses to return to his best friend SpongeBob, it isn't as simple as just deciding to leave? What if the reason that Patrick's followers were so dogmatically attached to him was because they were mind-controlled by Plankton to hang on his every word so that he could break up the heroes and keep his scheme going? And this becomes apparent when Patrick tries to leave them, but they panic and become very blatantly brainwashed as they need to seize him and hold him back because the plan's falling apart. You could even work in a few bars from No Control again here, all the more twisted than ever. And then later, when we have Patrick come back and save SpongeBob in that glorious slow-motion catch, it can be all the more triumphant. And yet the counterpoint to this triumph would be that those fists were only attracted to him because of the fact that they were mind-controlled, and that he should have known that no one would ever really find him smart, making for one more additional tragic outlook and counterpoint for the show's thematic structure. You know, oddly enough, there's perhaps nothing in the show more simultaneously amusing and actually kind of unsettlingly true a sign of utter futility as there is the big ticking clock. Literally, ticking clock, used to great effect at the end of the No Control number. Because there you go, that show's right there. It makes it quite plain, the notion of time ticking ahead. Nothing you could do about it, quite objectively. The only thing you can do about it is, of course, as SpongeBob would tell you, to spend it well. I think it can be even better if at specific low points in the story, like maybe the ones I came up with earlier in the video, you stop to just show that clock hauntingly ticking along for a few seconds. It could maybe even be great if near the end we do this, and then SpongeBob incorporates the ticks into the beat of his rousing Best Day Ever number, directly externalizing his self-aware and exuberant utilization of time. Because that's what SpongeBob ultimately believes, that there's no reason the day we're living right now can't be the greatest there's ever been, since there's no way to know until you open yourself up to the chance. SpongeBob's closing monologue leading into this song is great as is, but you could also maybe throw in some proof of how the world and the people who live in it are inherently good and worthy of being saved. That, thanks to my chains, Mr. Krabs was willing to give up all his money to save the town he loves. That Squidward, even if he didn't get to perform in front of everyone, still got to live out his fantasy, even if it was just inside his head. Like, SpongeBob, how do you know about that? And Sandy stayed with us, even though she had somewhere else she could go. And Patrick came back, even though he thought he'd become some sort of intellectual prophet. When, of course, he should have known that he's always been one. And I, well, for whatever reason, not everyone envies my status as lowly fry cook of the town's favorite grease trap. But I choose to think life in Bikini Bottom is life worth living. And Squidward would go, but why would you think that's true? And SpongeBob just simply responds, why would you want to live a life when it's not? Oh, wow, he twisted it. And that can lead us straight into the climactic song.
I'm glad I'm here with you.
Mr. Sun came up and he smiled at me.
You know, in many ways, this musical feels like it's trying to be the definitive SpongeBob project. Everyone from Mrs. Puff to Old Man Jenkins is represented, and we're mixing the SpongeBob yearning to be manager of the Krusty Krab thread from the first film with the mass hysteria stemming from an apocalypse thread from the second film. But what I'm trying to say with this video is that the musical needs to more intimately engage with the core ideals of SpongeBob throughout the entire running time. It nails it in moments like Bikini Bottom Day and Best Day Ever, of course. But, like, you know, the town hall meetings, while smartly written and entertaining, and also the subtext that also eventually comes to the surface is interesting. That's when the production feels like it's just transplanting SpongeBob into a familiar-feeling, witty, and light political satire that exists outside of it. Like, the characters are being inserted into a story that doesn't quite function in such a way to best serve them, rather than building on what the franchise has already established, and asserting those values, not inserting, asserting, as Plankton would say. And tangents like the Pearl and Crab subplot, as they currently are, sometimes feel more in service of giving all of the show's vast assortment of characters their due, rather than committing to what works best for this specific story. So on one end, it's too far away from SpongeBob, and on the other, it's almost too entrenched in it. And I want to emphasize that both of these are noble aspirations. It's just that a balance can be found. What's so great about the original 2004 film is that it expanded on the show's core values of SpongeBob's man-child nature.
What I'm trying to say is, you're just a kid. And to be a manager, you have to be a man.
This dichotomy between kid and man was one that was really ingrained into the original series. The guy goes to work, but he also can't get his driver's license. He lives alone and has a job, but he still acts like a kid and does kiddie things. He wants to get into the salty spittoon, but he's not seen as tough enough. He wants to be seen as a man, but he still enjoys his grandmother treating him like a child. What I can really give this musical credit for is that it actually does a really nice job showing how SpongeBob makes for a great manager. In the movie, it was just the goal, a position he strived for, being the highest you could go in the relative context of a fast food restaurant. But here, we see how SpongeBob's resourceful, personable, and optimistic attitude translates into management skills. Above all, I must say I love how this show is ultimately such an inclusive hodgepodge. There's just something so SpongeBobian about seeing all of these songwriters come together, and of course all of these disparate characters unite by the end in a surge of anarchic, albeit innocent, glee. Even Patchy the Pirate finally gets to join in on the fun. So building off these inclusive vibes, as I alluded to earlier, SpongeBob has always kind of been about imploring you to accept an invitation to, or concede the value of, something that a cynical outsider may not be interested in. Whether it's having Squidward finally try a Krabby Patty, or showing Mr. Krabs how much a little soda drinking hat may actually be worth. So I guess I just figured, with this video, why not throw my little opinions out there into the hodgepodge, which hopefully were similar to not just SpongeBob's optimism, or Squidward's cynicism, not just the light or the dark, but both at the same time. Thanks for watching.